And now to the analysis of Shields and Brooks. That is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Hello to both of you on this Friday night. We haven't seen you since the election was declared. Joe Biden was declared the winner, Mark. So what do you make? We have to ask you, what do you make of the result and how some of these final states went, Arizona, Georgia, and the others?
Well, I think I predicted every one of them, Judy. No, I guess I'm not surprised. Surprised at the margin and the margin that was so close. And I think that in retrospect, the campaign of Donald Trump deserves enormous credit for identifying and motivating and turning out voters who had were not regular voters and gave Trump the number of votes he had and probably made the difference almost surely in the Republicans picking up House seats and retaining the Senate. But the victory, it was rather remarkable to be here in Washington at the time. It had a VJ Day quality to it. I mean, not that dimension, the victory over Japan in World War II, but it's sort of a sense of public exhilaration, people smiling, just of goodwill, which had to be rather unsettling for the president as he came back from the golf club, because he had to go right by it in Lafayette Park. And to see this sort of sense of gaiety and New Year's Eve festivity that was felt.
David, what did you make of the result, of the call, the final call, how it ended?
Well, there was people playing Glory Days, a Springsteen song, in my neighborhood, too. And so at least in urban America, there's a lot of joy. 5 points is a pretty good victory, bigger than I thought it would be on election night or thereabouts. And so it's a good Biden win. I happen to think Joe Biden was the only Democratic nominee who could have won this election. There was a lot more pro-Trump support than we thought. There was not a great pro-Democratic Party generic support as much as we thought. I think the Democrats need to get over this idea that they are the emerging majority party. This idea has been around because of demographic things or other things. And there's been an assumption that demography is on our side. And I think it's just time to accept that's just not going to happen. We're going to be a pretty 50-50 country. I'll believe a change when I see it. And it's becoming more polarized on education, with Democrats becoming the party more and more of the college educated, the Republicans becoming more and more the college, the high school educated, and geography. The urban-rural divide is wider than ever. And so we are just locked into some sort of either gridlock or compromise. We'll see, but it's 50-50 almost.
Mark, what about that? I mean, you mentioned that the Democrats didn't do as well as they thought they would in the Senate or in the House. They lost seats in the House.
No, that's right, Judy. David makes a good point. This has been a year of expectations, if you recall, and raised expectations. Donald Trump raised the expectations going into the first debate that Vice President Biden was non-compos, that he couldn't finish a sentence, that he would fall asleep on the stage, none of which, of course, happened. Vice President Biden handled himself well, prevailed, and that may have been the defining event of the fall campaign. Democrats had expectations, great expectations about winning the Senate, about enlarging the House majority, all of which came up quite short. I think the argument that one party control is strong, that there was a resistance to that, the Republicans made the case. And I think just language like defund the police really came back to haunt Democrats and hurt them in suburban and marginal districts. And I think you'll see a fractiousness and a division. It's already there within the Democratic House caucus, within the Democratic Party at large over this. There isn't a natural Democratic majority that is inevitable in the country. And I think that was a lesson to be learned on November 3rd.
So, David, is there a way to put a finer point on it? The country is divided, as you're both saying. There's not a natural Democratic majority. So what is it? What do we have?
Well, we probably have gridlock, but I hope not. You know, I spent a bunch of this week calling around the Senate, speaking to senators like Mitt Romney, and asking him, is there any way to get 60 votes around some issues just so we can pass some things and help some people? And Romney came up with a whole bunch of topics, the Dreamers, the immigration, some budget stuff, some healthcare stuff, prescription drugs. He said, sure. And then I talked to other aides, and they came up with national service, infrastructure. And so there's at least a eagerness on the part of a lot of senators to actually vote for legislation, something they have not been allowed to do under Mitch McConnell, and pass things. Will McConnell allow votes to come to the floor? Will he cooperate and play ball? Well, nobody would bet on that. But I'm struck by a desire to get out of the stuckness that has marked legislative bodies for the past couple of years.
Interesting about what Romney said. But, you know, speaking of Mitch McConnell, Mark, he is staying with President Trump's insistence that he's not only within his rights to challenge the election, he's not conceding, that he needs to pursue every legal avenue. In fact, Republicans are virtually in lockstep. Only a few of them don't support the president. Lasting impacts of that? Is it just, are we going to be over it soon? What do you see?
Judy, that Donald Trump is going out as a sore loser. I think he's making a serious mistake, and his future obviously is not bright. I mean, you can talk about 24, but there's an awful lot of investigations and judicial action between now and 2024. Mitch McConnell is kind of fascinating. If you go back to December of 2008, which I did, and you're free to look at it, the Senate had a send-off for Joe Biden, who had just been elected vice president, and senators made their statements. Mitch McConnell wrote his own statement. It was quite moving and quite personal about Joe Biden, and that Joe Biden was the rare creature who could reach across the aisle to Jesse Helms, to Strom Thurmond, or to me, and he became my friend. I think this will be tested. I really do. I think he's awfully, he's key. He's important in this. And one thing that was lost in the campaign is that Joe Biden is one of the great retail politicians of this generation. He is wonderful with people, people of all sorts. He was deprived of that. We never saw it. We never saw him with people in the campaign. They ran a good campaign, a disciplined campaign. But I think when you get Joe Biden in the White House as president, bringing those personal skills together, I think that the chances are improved, and I'm more optimistic, I guess, maybe than David is.
And David, I want to ask you about the Biden prospects, but just quickly on the president's refusal to concede, is this something that leaves a lasting scar, or does it go away quickly? What do you see?
Well, I think Trump has left a lasting scar. The whole entity, the whole entirety of the existential presence of Trump has left a lasting scar on our norms, on the way we feel each other, about the way the world looks at us. Dictators around the world are happy to see an American president denying election results. That gives them encouragement and gives them a set of norms they can hew to. You know, I expect him to go. You can feel the air coming out of the balloon, the stages of grief. Denial, then rage, and then acceptance, though with Trump there's more rage and more denial. But you feel the Republicans walking away, rightly or wrongly, just not wanting to get in front of the train and push him out. That's a wrong metaphor, but but you feel him losing momentum. And I do think he will eventually whimper out, probably without ever admitting defeat and probably without attending Joe Biden's inauguration. But that is the way the man is.
Mm. A lot of people wondering about that. And David, yeah. I just want to ask David on Biden's prospects to respond to Mark, what you said a moment ago.
Yeah, well, I'm maintaining my posture of unrealistic optimism. And so I do think there's some chance of actually working together. You look at the people Joe Biden is hiring. They're experienced. Ron Klain is chief of staff, experience at pandemic fighting, experienced at Washington. You look at the people running the task force, the COVID task force, Vivek Murthy, the former Surgeon General, Atul Gawande's on this task force. We're just getting an A-team. You know, with Trump, we never got the Republican A-team. With Biden, it looks like we're going to get the Democratic A-team. So that's got to make you feel good.
And I was struck, Dr. Murthy, when we talked to him a few minutes ago, used the term humility several times. Mark, I interrupted you. Go ahead.
No, I just following up on the point of President Trump. Here in Washington, Judy, power is the perception of power. If I think you've got power, and David thinks you've got power, people, you have power. And that's the reality now. You can feel the power has moved from Donald Trump to Joe Biden. The world is called, Erdogan is called, the only unheard of, Kim Jong-un is on the line. No, but he'll be already writing a letter to Joe Biden. He and Putin are kind of the holdouts, the bitter enders. But that's the reality, that the power has left Donald Trump. And so the question is, when does that reality set in with him?
And David, to put a punctuation mark, you see it coming.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to, I don't know if it'll be before Inauguration Day, but, you know, Republicans are beginning to urge Trump to give Biden the press, the intelligence briefings. And so as they begin to do that, that's just part of a process of withdrawal.
And we will see about the inauguration. David Brooks, Mark Shields, on this Friday night, we thank you both so much.
Thank you.